actor who's over on Facebook watching. Let's, as usual, begin with a word of prayer. Gracious God, in these chapters of Ephesians, Paul breaks out into prayer before you, the Father, from whom every nation draws its name. Help us to think about what you've done for us in Christ, to break down the dividing wall of hostility, initially between Jew and Gentile, and for us this day, which walls and what hostility and what work left to be done. Give us your wisdom so that we might know you in all of your depth and beauty. We pray for this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we are in Ephesians 2:11. We are picking up just after that incredible passage in the second chapter about by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. We connected that grace to the life of good works, which even the life of good works is described as something God does through us, that God has prepared beforehand to be our way of life, so that from the start of our relationship to God to the life in Christ, we are not we don't have anything to boast of ourselves, but to boast in the Lord. So now in verse 11, I'll read. So then, remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is the hostility between us. I'm clicking admit for Roger and Patty here, so we'll see them in a minute.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Good morning, Roger and Patty. Oh, it didn't connect. Oh, there we go. Hi, Roger. Oh, we can't hear you, but it's, yeah, you're not connected to audio. Oh, now it's trying again. Let's see here. Good morning, Roger.
Good morning.
How are you and Patty?
We're doing well. Patty told me to be sure to be on time, and I wasn't.
Hey, nope. Well, I don't see her, so what's she saying that?
Well, she's saying I want a little less color in my hair right now.
Okay, very good. We're right in the middle of a section in chapter 2, and we've made it to verse 15. Paul's just talking about Christ breaking down the dividing wall between Gentiles and Jews.
And he okay, continues. We are where?
Ephesians 2:15.
Oh, Ephesians.
Yeah. Christ has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who are far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Isn't that incredible?
Yeah. And therefore, we now have 1,000 denominations.
That's right. Exactly right. I know. Yep, the ongoing deal. I'm preparing for the Sunday class, and it's going to be about the turning point of the Reformation. But I was reading all of the intervening chapters, and I just read a chapter on the Great Schism between East and West, and then how it took centuries now into the 20th century to begin to have ecumenical conversations between the Pope and then the Eastern leaders of Constantinople. In any case, this is something where Paul says what Christ has done And we who have eyes to see and ears to hear say, what are you talking about, Paul? And this hostility, this peace that's been achieved in the midst of hostility, notice where it takes place and through what means it takes place. It's not through ecumenical conversations. It's not through even our worship or our being able to sort of worship together. It's on the cross. It's through the cross. In Christ and through the ministration of his cross, there is unity. There is no other access to the Father but through the one Spirit who gives us Christ crucified and brings us to the Father. There's no other way. And so unity is not a human achievement. It's not something we can point to or see and observe, but it is something that Christ has accomplished. There is one holy Catholic and apostolic church in him, and the divisions is our problem and a reflection of our own sin and obstinacy, and of course just a byproduct of human history and the ways that strewn across the ancient world initially and then strewn across the modern world, which is now only in recent years being globalized and brought back together into conversation. Sometimes just the way history unfolds leads to divisions. And as one generation leads to another, we end up looking a little bit dissimilar, even though we worship the same God and have the same scriptures in our hands. Well, of course, initially here, we have the division of Jew and Gentile. N.T. Wright gives the picture of a larger stream and a smaller stream that have now become one in the confluence of Jesus Christ. So that although Israel had been given the law and the prophets and the promises and the covenants and everything else, it is the Gentiles as well who are being brought into the great stream. And really, it's not just that Gentiles are brought into the Jewish stream, but that it is together as they come together in Christ, there is both continuity and change for the people of God.
That's really a great metaphor. I'm reading a book right now about the H.J. Andrews experimental forest up on the McKinsey. Mm-hmm. And it's 15,000 acres. It has a watershed with Blue River as its destination. And the streams are sometimes hidden. They don't even go where they're supposed to be. But sometimes I think the church is hidden as well. That we hear it and see it sometimes, but we don't always recognize it. Yeah. And it's hidden from us in ways that we don't even understand.
That's right. And that's a great anticipation of both what Eugene Peterson has to say about these chapters for us, and just what is to come in Paul's. He's going to move from this dividing wall cast down. He's going to move into talking about the mystery, the revelation that's come. And then from there, he's going to break out into prayer. In all these ways, Paul helps us to see what we've always seen but never seen, what we've always heard but never actually heard, and reveal things to us.
You know, you talked about the Benedictines last Sunday, and I always remember something I read about the Benedictines and experiencing that. If those men are all about hospitality, loving unconditionally, working to support themselves, they are a hidden community in many ways. And they only are shown through their hospitality to others. And sometimes I think that the church would be better if we were about that more often. And I can't really explain that, but I think it's easily understood that we need to look at each other and say, Christ has given us love for each other. Therefore, no matter what, that love has to override all the rest. And, you know, that's what I kind of mean by the hidden church. We know when we find the church in our midst because of the love that we feel.
You know, during this Susan, this is kind of like a grace thing, so it's hard to say we set out to or we happened into, but my husband and I, because we were outsiders in our neighborhood and we're from a different state, and we've never lived where people had fences around their yards, because fences are a silly thing in Wyoming because the wind blows so much that you end up with trash and snowdrift if you put up a fence. So there were no fences, and if there were, they were chain link. And so moving into a neighborhood or into a, our closest neighbor there was half a mile away. So having people all around us all the time and then being fenced off from one another made no sense to us at all. It just didn't. So we threw a big party before COVID started and invited all of our neighbors, and they didn't even know each other. And we didn't know, they didn't, we didn't care. We invited, and we pestered people and ended up with 40 people in our backyard. And that was before COVID started. And we were just doing what you do in Wyoming. You need your neighbors or you will die. I mean, and so, but then COVID came, and I am not kidding you. What has happened with about the 8 houses around me, the ones I can see out of our windows? It's just a grace. One of the gentlemen had surgery last week, and his wife texted me to go pick up something at the drugstore for them. The lady on the other side made a donation in our name to some children's things because I invited her kids over to play with my puppies. The lady in another direction last week called to say, I'm going to go get my COVID test. I'm afraid I've, you know, and would you pray for me? And we're just watching it. And it's every single day. These people all boarded off from one another behind fences. And we have nothing in common. I mean, honestly, we're finding we do, but I mean, the gentleman here I know voted a lot different than our household did, and our household didn't vote one line. And the gentleman over this way I know is completely different, but the neighbor 4 houses down the other way said, weren't you proud of our neighborhood for not putting up any signs? And I hadn't even thought of that. I said, oh, Kim, you're right. None of us put up any signs. And it's because we didn't want to draw those lines, you know, during the election. So it's just a grace that God has given that I haven't experienced, except in church. I mean, you think you get it in church, but we're all so much the same that there aren't really barriers to overcome quite like we think, you know.
That's really incredible, Mary. What a great neighbor you are. And
it's my husband. He is restless and social.
Well, we haven't met him, so we don't know if he exists. So,
well, he's fine.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm thinking of a couple of things, but it's just so funny that the Spirit drew that connection through out of you, because I don't have it in this very section of Ephesians, but in the next chapter, Eugene Peterson talks about this picture he keeps on his desk. And it's an aerial view of a neighborhood, the suburb where he spent, 30 some odd years as a church planter. And in the area, he used it as a metaphor for his suburbia. This was an aerial view of a place where there's swimming pools in every backyard. So it wouldn't have been Baltimore, Maryland. the aerial view, it was neat subdivision, all the fences, all the lines, and all the pools in the backyard. And he talks about growing up in Montana, which is not far from Wyoming. Oh. And he says, nobody had fences when I was a kid. We roamed and, and we had, what did he say? We had one community pool and no fences. And then I planted a church in a neighborhood that had just the opposite. And he says when he became a church planter, he thought he had two things to do, sort of draw people to worship and then build community. And he thought the second one was going to be easy and the first one was going to be the trick. But he says it was actually pretty easy to get people to worship. This is 40 years ago, but it was actually a great challenge for people to actually be interested in their neighbors. And that breakthrough was a lot harder slog.
Well, it didn't come without embarrassment. I mean, I went and knocked on the neighbor's door. We were in town a week, just telling her who I was and hand off a card and tell it with my phone number on it. And she unlocked 5 locks to let me in. Wow. Now, I moved from where we didn't always even have locks on our doors. And so I didn't realize it wasn't like a mission. It was more like being dropped into China or something. Or it was cultural, and you just bring your culture with you because you can't help it, kind of.
But you know, Mary, I grew up, Roger and I both grew up right here in this 3 mile area, and we both grew up without fences, didn't we, Roger?
Yeah, and I didn't know what a lock was until I was 5.
Yeah, right.
We were going to Nebraska, and my dad was locking up the house. What are you doing?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, and everybody, all the little kids in the neighborhood run from one house to the next. And, you know, we were always, you know, and the streets weren't paved. So we had ditches and all kinds of stuff. It was kind of a mini farm. You know, we were surrounded by chicken farms and that kind of thing. So, you know, and so we've slowly changed from that atmosphere to this sense of nobody can find their neighbors because they're behind the fences and behind locked doors.
Yeah, in some ways, you know, the story of Bethesda has been moving from a parish church to a program church.
Right.
And then now post-program, post-parish, what are we? We don't have the same capacity for, you know, an entire smorgasbord of programs. And a lot of the core is either, you know, ready to pass it on to someone else or is tired. But we have people and we have programs, but what's, you know, what's the defining kind of life of the church going to be, can be, you know, mm-hmm. and it doesn't have to take one shape. There's a lot of energy around food ministry and clothing ministry or various things, but I think we're kind of have these two heritages. We have a real strong core of Bethesdians who remember the parish life. You were neighbors, not only at church, but in your neighborhood, to now, you know, perhaps a joint interest that a program can provide might have bring this or that kind of person, but we're even past that now. And what are we coming out of the pandemic? What do we prioritize?
What God wants to do next. I mean,
yeah, I'm totally
curious, real curious, because I know, I mean, I'm sorry you didn't see a lock till you were 5. We didn't use locks till I was in my mid-60s. So it's like, no, the past goes away. I mean, it does. And I'm real curious, kind of excited, actually.
You're going to find out.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are. But, you know, Roger, I think about, we celebrated everybody. We had potlucks. We gathered together for picnics regularly. We always were celebrated the 50th anniversaries, the birthday, you know, the 80th birthdays. Remember, we had an 80th birthday. Well, of course, we all live longer now, but you know, we were, there was that parish family thing that everybody went to. And I think partly because in those days, people worked hard. They didn't have time to do any of that kind of stuff on any other day of the week. And we all came together, and that was our community.
Yeah. That was our social outlet.
Yeah, the only one we had. And, you know, so many people in our congregation met their wives and husbands in that setting, including Tom.
Yeah, including me. I know. I know.
Yeah.
When I saw the middle school thing, you know, I can't remember the word.
Confirmation?
Class. Yeah.
Confirmation.
I know that's program, but it, like you, Judy, going, oh, I wish we could have parish things. I raised my children with programs. And so to see that, and I don't have children to raise anymore, but it was like, oh, I remember the beauty of just the beauty of my daughter's confirmation classes and the closing of that. And how affirming that is to a middle school, you know, I mean, so I think there's value in each time. I mean, and I don't know what God is doing, but
I keep thinking of occasionally I think of the irony that just before the pandemic, we had these big plans to make Palm Sunday a fun day. We basically said we're going to have one worship service. We're going to go straight into the parish hall for a potluck. And then the kids can do Easter egg hunts, you know, kind of rotate through because we haven't had fun together in a while. And we had all these plans that, you know, I met with the women's ministry team, with the altar guild. And then it was like, then of course COVID happens. And we said, well, maybe we'll be able to open by Easter. We probably can't do a meal on Palm Sunday, but we could open by Easter and make that a big thing. Well, you know how that goes.
Yeah.
So you get these little indications of what we can be, but it's a real challenge. Something Eugene Peterson says about this breaking down of the dividing wall, he uses the word that Judy tipped us off to earlier, which is that church is something we can't see. He says we can't see the ascension of Jesus or the descent of the dove. We can't see sins washed away. We can't see the birth of a soul. We can't see the river of life. It's not uncommon for people to walk into a church out of curiosity, look around, leave, and then later report to their friends, "I couldn't see that there is anything to it." That is also a very unspiritual thing to say, for a great deal of what we live by is unseen, the air we breathe and the promises we make for a start. So as Paul, you know, not only talks about this dividing wall, but now says this one people who have been brought together, I mean, we saw these descriptions of the people being brought together as a temple, as this new temple founded on the apostolic teaching. And then the cornerstone, of course, is Christ, who draws the whole thing together. That now the dwelling place of God is this people of God who have crossed ethnic boundaries and all the rest of those boundaries. And it's an incredible change. I hear my preschooler coming down. Let me say hi to him. Hi, Emmett. There's that stuff, and you can go in the other room if you wish to. Now, there you go. Can you see here, Emmett? Stay here for a second. Can you see Emmett?
Hi, Emmett.
Show him what you have. This is his cardboard baby. So we made a little cardboard baby, and he brought it to preschool for show and tell this week. And I don't know, he's practicing. When we pick up his brothers at school, he puts cardboard baby in a car seat and carries them out to the van and sticks them in the van. So,
of course.
Yeah.
Good.
Anyway.
Just wait till he tries that for real.
Right? Yep.
Don't drop him.
Even as we say that the church is invisible, or at least, you know, some of the good stuff is beyond our notice sometimes. Peterson also, you know, of course, warns us against being very American and turning everything into pragmatism so that the church is understood in terms of function, effectiveness, staging grounds to motivate people to do some work. And he talks about a church tempted to call time out and huddle together with heads bowed and figure out a strategy by which we can compensate for God's regrettable invisibility. And again, just not attending to the unseen operations of the Trinity among us, but again, talking as if God's not here. And of course, a classic way that can be seen is like at a congregational annual meeting, which the annual meetings of recent years have been different than the first ones. I remember going to the first ones when I was a youth worker, and Pastor Ralph and Pastor Troy and I would leave the room at a certain point in the meeting, and I was new and oblivious, and I just like, why does this meeting sound like God's not a part of it at all? Like, there's no trust that God's going to provide or that God's calling us into these different ministries. And that was just sort of an offhanded comment at that time. But it is difficult, isn't it? We have a visible church and institution that we care about, and we have ideas. We have to do something. But how does our language blend so that we can talk about the business of the church and the being of the church as the temple of the unseen God, uniting us and calling us together and into mission? I mean, how do we unite these things in our language? It seems like sometimes we use one set of words on one side, and then we go over here and use a different set of words. I notice this when I go to like synod pastor conferences, we have worship, and we use biblical language in worship. And then we begin our business meetings, and there's absolutely no talk of Jesus whatsoever. It's just very, you know, very vague words about, you know, doing the work and coming together and listening. And it's as if there's these two different language. It's like a bilingual church, but it doesn't fit together.
And, you know, there's some, I did that for 1981 through 1993. I was in North Pacific District and Oregon Synod, and you're right. But the reason for that is because that big group of people isn't a community. They don't feel like a community. But when you're with another smaller group of people, that hidden group, there is a community. And so we always have to remember that and keep things in perspective, because you know, hopefully there are friendship groups among pastors in our synod. Hopefully that lay people who work hard are a community. And the same thing is in our church. Where are the communities in the midst of our own worship place?
Yeah.
And remembering that God leads people within those smaller communities, not, you know, at a huge conference.
Yeah.
And not that God can't lead people in those places,
sure,
but we can't see it as real, you know, it isn't a reality for us.
No, that's helpful. And I think too of the difference between if you're to speak in general about American divisions, and then you're going to actually walk around Mary's neighborhood with her and knock on some doors and meet some neighbors, you'll find that people generally get along and don't have to agree on everything. And actually, you know, don't have to sort of totalize and say, well, if this person voted this way, they must be, you know, a racist homophobe. Or if this person voted that way, they must be a communist who loves murdering children. So, you know, that stuff gets out of hand so quickly. And it happens too among, you know, not just within a denomination, but I have more friendships with pastors outside of my denomination. And that becomes really, you know, interesting to me, because you realize just, you know, what we have in common is so much stronger than the dividing lines we erect, which are usually around different things. You know, what divides a Baptist from a Presbyterian is going to be different than what divides a Lutheran from, you know, an evangelical. We all have our bailiwicks.
But you're following the pattern, Tom. That was true for Ralph and Troy and a number of other pastors I know.
Just to make friends outside.
There's Bethesda pastors have always been kind of on the edges of the big church, and I've always sought fellowship on the edges. I'm still talking to 92-year-old Pastor Bruner. He's certainly on the edge.
Well, yeah, and I've renewed so Pastor Bruner's son Dan Bruner.
Yeah, right.
Is a really close friend of a college friend of mine named AJ Swoboda. He's an author. He's got some great books out there.
Right.
And AJ has moved back to Eugene, and our sons are best friends now. And so AJ like blew his mind that he, you know, that we have Dan Bruner's confirmation photo in the entryway. And But AJ and I were talking the other night about, you know, he says, I'm so excited to see what Jesus is going to do in the next 2 years in the church, because there's such a pruning going on, both a pruning of sort of people's own affiliation with their church, but also a pruning going on with our affiliation of church and state and other related matters. And he speaks with a very, you know, hopeful spirit about where is this going to go? Because when you trust Jesus, then you know the church is never going to die, because Jesus is the church and he's quite alive. But what might die is our own personal idols of Lutheranism or church the way we've known it, or, you know, you name it. Church as a reflection of a nation that coincides with my faith. All those kinds of things. Perhaps those idols are being smashed, but the church is alive and well because he is risen.
And as long as we have people around us that we've loved all our lives, that's not going to go away either.
Yeah.
You have to remember that in a church like ours, it's been around for 125 years, those relationships are not going to end. They might, the relationships themselves, I don't think will necessarily change. I think it's what we do that will change.
Yeah.
I want to move us back to verse 16 in our text, in our scriptures. Making peace and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. Mm-hmm. I'm doing some pretty deep study on some things, and one of them is, a couple months ago, I was studying the atonement, and currently I'm studying more about unity and all of those things. Well, I've shared with this group, I think, that I have like 13 crosses around my house. It's just a funny little custom I got and ended up with one in every room. Well, the cross in this room, there's actually two, but the cross in this room, I took off of our cemetery when my husband and I were cemetery owners. And every so often you would clear everything. And this was a crucifix, of course. And I had never had one because I was Protestant. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that wasn't what we did. We hung up empty crosses, and all the others in my house are empty crosses. But this has come to mean a ton to me because of the arms wide open and the naked vulnerability and trust in God. And this week in particular, the arms wide open has really appealed to me. And so yesterday during some of my quiet time, I was making list of times in scripture when you read about being welcomed with open arms, you know, the father of the prodigal and Jesus on the cross. I was just thinking about that even as I listened to the president last night and then the Republican rebuttal, just thinking about, okay, Mary, arms wide open. Arms wide open and completely vulnerable with through trust. And it really has impacted me. And so I'm really grateful to be reading this today, right there, you know, that's the peace.
No, it is. And that peace has been achieved. And so any division we see is not true in God's eyes, and it's not justifiable by us.
Yeah.
You know, there's a brand new book by a best-selling evangelical author named Francis Chan, and his new book is called Until Unity. And I've read a couple of Chan's books, and I think it produces anxiety and not gospel. And I have, you know, I've had some criticisms of him, and this book itself, like, I know his heart is let's get together, let's get along and stuff, but it just, because he doesn't understand the gospel, unity is something for us to still achieve, and it's hard. It's just hard to see. I mean, you know.
I agree with that completely, completely. My favorite book of his is Crazy Love. Otherwise.
Well, you should read my review of Crazy Love on Goodreads, because I think it's garbage.
It's been a long time since I read it.
Yeah.
Probably 10 years.
I think it's very troubling.
That's what drew me. That's how where I got introduced.
Well, what could possibly be wrong with love and loving like crazy?
But I had the same sense you do, that going, this looks like immature faith. That's all. I mean, until you're to unity, how mature is your faith? If we're still.
Let's get a little further into, let's go into chapter 3. First 13 verses of chapter 3 fit together in terms of God's manifold wisdom. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words. A reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant, according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery, hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the wisdom of God and its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. I pray, therefore, that you may not lose heart over my sufferings for you. They are your glory. Eugene Peterson points out that there is no such thing as BC. There is no before Christ. Paul fills us in on what's been going on before the foundation of the world. And that this is a mystery, but it is a mystery which has now been revealed in Christ, which has brought together all the peoples of the world in him. And not through the law, but through his death and resurrection. And this wisdom then should guide us as church, so that the church doesn't become a program or an add-on to help us be better Christians. That church isn't sort of a bonus, like here you're a Christian, and then if you can find a nice church, that's great too. But that the church instead is God's second great creation story. It's the creation that has a long prehistory in the people of God and of Israel, but it is a creation of God. And there is no not being part of the church. And of course, we have an increasing, I think, number of de-churched Christians for various reasons. Some of it is just now you fall out of the habit, but some of it is, of course, harm. Some of it, of course, is conflict. Some of it is just, you haven't found that perfect combination of worship and belief, et cetera, that just kind of makes the ingredients come together nicely. We have such variety, and as Americans, we know about voluntary association. We prize this. And so whichever churches have mapped themselves closely to the American geography have done really well. And churches that try to carry on or carry forward a tradition are always countercultural to some extent, and on it goes. But here Paul is talking about a mystery which has always been there, that God's plan has always been to bring together Jew and Gentiles in Christ. We haven't gotten here yet, but Paul is going to pray at the end of this chapter about the Father from whom all people or all nations draw their name. And this has always been plan A, that he would call a specific people to carry the promise and to steward the promise, to also in their own failures and shortcomings be witnesses of the God who promises and is faithful despite our own stiff-neckedness. And then of course, in the coming of Christ now, this guardianship has reached its end. And now we live not under law, but under grace, and we live in Christ. There's a nice poem from Mary Oliver called Moonlight. And Peterson quotes her at the beginning of his chapter on this. She says, "Take care you don't know anything in this world too quickly or easily. Everything is also a mystery and has its own secret aura in the moonlight, its private song." So here's Paul. We get a little glimpse of his biography here, not a lot, but he describes himself in this section as a prisoner, as a servant, as the recipient of revelation, and then especially in verse 8, the least of all the saints. And it's actually even greater than least. He kind of coins a grammatical construction. He takes a superlative like least, but then he actually adds a comparative on top of this superlative. So he's actually like, it's almost like leastester or smallester. It basically means like, I'm not the least of the saints. I'm less than the least of the saints. I'm like super leastest of the saints. And Peterson has this one nice phrase. He says, Paul is last in the roll call of saints and first in the roll call of sinners. I think about the difference of that. I mean, that the mystery that's been revealed, it isn't the mystery that, lo and behold, I, Paul, am a spiritual guru who has either attained a revelation through my own connection to the divine or has achieved this calling to be an apostle and this authority because I'm gifted. But instead, the mystery kept hidden of this Christ who brings together the world in a cross, that this mystery leads him to say, unbelievable. I surely I'm last in line for such glorious riches.
You know, something you said before, and I think it kind of fits here, is that Paul, saint and sinner, Judy, Mary, Roger, Sandy, Tom, saint and sinner, we're never going to be anything else. And so we look at each other and we can either love each other or decide we don't like you because of some barrier or obstacle. But having fun together makes a huge difference. And I think probably in our transition here, that might be still one of the best ways to go, is to simply have Bethesda start having fun together, being together, learning to know each other better, laughing together, having a talent show, you know, doing whatever it takes to just bring people together and say, hey, we're all in this together. We are all saints and sinners. We need to learn to be a community again.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, for sure. Yep.
I read a poem this morning. I sometimes study troubling things, and because that's what I see mystery as being, is you can't get one right answer and there, I'm done with that. I mean, mystery is open-ended. And so I let my mind play with things that maybe I wouldn't embrace. And I'm not going to let you know either way on this because I'm not sure, but it's a poem that I read early in order to ponder. And this is what it reads. A prayer for the exiles. Holy One, have mercy on your exiles, those of us who no longer fit within the traditional teachings of the church, those whose voice falters in the songs, who cannot say amen, who desperately think of something else during the sermon, those who think the greatest heresy of all is to say that you require suffering and death in order to forgive, those who are given up on going to church at all, have mercy. Holy God, those exiles who cling to faith and yearn for a bigger, wider story, a bigger, wider community, a story that embraces the vast expanses of time and space and the enormous complexity of the cosmos, a community in which everything and everyone is connected and embraced. Holy God, as we approach the Feast of Incarnation, be born again in us, your exiles. Tell your story in words that we can understand. Create from us a new community.
Gorgeous.
Who wrote that? Or did you write that?
I did not write that. Just a person.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Just a lady, nobody fancy. Sure. But I had some people that's just, I thought, oh, they would say this. I mean, I have some dear ones who have left the church and there's reason. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just going, so that's part of why I study it, you know, part of it.
Why are we hearing chickens?
Oh, we have chickens.
Oh, okay.
Somebody's celebrating something here. Oh. Yeah. But,
wonderful, Mary.
Yeah. Yep. One, and at its best, doctrine is going to help, doctrine is going to help protect an honest truth of things because we are one in Christ and not through our own schemes, then doctrine is going to protect the person and the work of Christ. It's going to help us to understand what we need to know and set aside what we don't need to know or don't know. And it's going to give us that assessment of ourselves as well, that one of the first things that happens when we get unmoored from doctrine is that we begin to think highly of ourselves, puff ourselves up with knowledge, and that leads to certainty. And instead, this mystery kept hidden through the ages leads Paul to consider himself the least of the saints, but it's not in a shameful way, because he writes so often in his letters about that we're not in shame, we're not under shame. But instead, learning how to say, instead of sinner being a term of shame, it becomes a boasting in Christ. It becomes a confession that I'm fearful. I'm concerned for myself first, but you know, thanks be to God for what Christ has done for me. And it's just so. Actually, I forgot where I read this last night. It was I'm always reading different books at the same time, so I don't remember where it was, but it was this quote that basically said, like, we have such a deep need to justify ourselves, and it was talking about how even psychotic people like who've like done great crimes, like they almost always have a justification for what they've done, or they try to justify what they're doing. It's just so built into us. And I think that this wisdom that is revealed in a cross says, you know, whatever we all have in common as people and tribes and tongues and nations, one of the things we have in common is that in fear of death, we would rather inflict that death upon a scapegoat or upon someone else, especially if that person is running too wild with mercy and love, than to take up that cross ourselves. Peterson also, he loves Gerard Manley Hopkins as his poetry, but Hopkins also wrote this thing. He coined this word that's in contrast to landscape. He talks about inscape. And Hopkins talks about inscape as the intuitive sense that what we see is a living organic form that strikes through the senses and into the mind with a feeling of novelty and discovery. It's what something uniquely is. It holds together whatever you're looking at or listening to. So inscape is this, I talked about this earlier, that idea that artists help us to see what we've always seen, or to hear what we've actually always heard, but it never been taken in by. He talks about the artist, the tree we walked past every morning was always there, but the artist helps us to be taken in by what the tree has to say. Peterson says, American culture is doing its dead level best with its celebrities, consumerism, and violence to keep us in a perpetually arrested state of adolescence. Yet all the while, the church is quietly and without false advertising, immersing us in the conditions of becoming mature to the measure of the full stature of Christ. And that's a challenge. The full stature of Christ, which includes this mystery that the least of all saints are nevertheless welcomed with open arms to the Christ on the cross. There's a new book coming out. I don't think I'm necessarily going to read it, because I kind of feel like I've heard this person's piece, but it's called Preachers and Sneakers. I don't know if you've heard about this viral sensation, Preachers and Sneakers. So a couple of years ago, this guy started noticing that celebrity pastors were dressed very nicely, like $3,000 sneakers and, you know, all the kind of fancy stuff. And he just, at first he just thought it was kind of, he just put it out there as a example. He would put a picture of the preacher on stage, and then a zooming in of the shoe, and then a zooming in of the product page on the website where you can buy the shoe. And so Preachers in Sneakers just took off, like 100,000 followers in the first couple of weeks. And it brought all kinds of criticism as well as, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Well, now 2 years later, he's just now publishing the book about this experience and basically getting at what Peterson's talking about, which is the American church has to come to terms with our celebrity consumer desires that, you know, what holds the church together nowadays is not Christ crucified, that leads us to our own boasting in him and our own confession of our leastness, but instead we've got all of these denominations of one pastor with a platform online who, you know, seemingly holding all these people together who can't find a local church that can come close to competing, and doing so all with the allure of riches and success hand in hand with that. You know, our class the last couple of weeks on Sunday has been talking about the impact of the church and the state or and the emperor becoming intertwined. And in some ways in the United States, perhaps the thing to consider is, yes, church and state, but really it's church and consumerism, how everything is understood in consumer terms. Right. From choosing a church to choosing which, you know, which type of worship you prefer to everything else. That is a real hard thing. And sometimes it's easier to argue about politics or racism or some of these other things, because what we don't want to talk about is what we all love, which is possessions and money and status, you know, and just, you know, and that's, you know, that comes up a lot. It's easier to talk about racism instead of talking about classism and what happens to poor people of all colors in contrast to the powerful. All right, it's the end of the hour, but do you have something hanging on your lips that you just needed me to stop talking for?
What was the contrast word besides inscape that you had there?
He was inscaping it, or he was contrasting it with landscape. Just the difference between seeing what's before you versus that wisdom.
Because I've been studying the mystics, and I've spent some time recently on Dark Night of the Soul, which you may know, but I studied it several years ago, but the meaning of mystics keeps getting deeper because they always write as mystery, so to speak. And he did a really interesting, in the center of that, it says God, and then it works out, you know, through the intellect, memory, will, the spiritual to the sensory. And it really gives you a perspective of whether you look out or whether you look in. And first you look out. I mean, that's what infants do. And they look out to make sense of their world, and you need to. That's the first half of life, huh, Judy? We read about that. But it's the slow learning to look in, I think, is where you notice the tree in your neighborhood, if you will, or maybe your neighbor himself. So, but
good.
I appreciate it.
And remembering, Tom, that, you know, as I heard all of this today, and I'm sure I'll be thinking about it, is that it's one of the reasons that we appreciate you and other pastors who just plod along and preach the gospel. And, you know, it really doesn't matter about all the other stuff, as long as we hear that Christ crucified message that reminds us who we really are, which is saint and sinner. But that if we are constantly in tune with that gospel message, then as a community together, then we can put aside some of the other stuff that we are all involved in. And it's the one place, probably the only place, where we can put that aside.
Right. No, and I mean, where other than a sports stadium, where do the generations still cross paths?
Right. Yeah.
I think that's part of the reason why churches are so up and down and this and that, like, it's because we have generation gaps, larger generation gaps than we've ever had in human history. Even just, you know, I mean, I don't recognize adolescence any from, not even from when I was an adolescent, but even from, you know, 10 years ago. And these gaps are widening, and you can't just, an American thinks you're going to have to create or find the church that fits with my generation, but the church is intergenerational. And if we're not, we are just blind to the great stream of tradition, and incapable of a word that comes from the outside.
Well, and there's too many words coming from the outside. Yeah. And that, you know, that's part of it, is that, you know, I look at my own grandchildren and they have so much coming in to their lives that,
yeah,
and so little coming in about their, that inscape, that God in the midst of them. It's pretty scary when you think about it. But on the other hand, where do we find that community, and where do we find that place where we can safely talk about the very thing that's important to us?
Yeah.
You know, last weekend, my two granddaughters spent the night with me, and the 8-year-old and I watched the movie Raya and the Last Dragon. And she'd never been to church, but a couple of times with me. So her world's different in those respects. But in that movie, there was a place in it where the father does this thing with his daughter, and it has bubbles and one thing and another. And I said, oh, look at that, Kella. That's just like baptism. And it was because he was passing on the family gift of power, so to speak, or gift. It was a gift. And their gift was unity in her family. And then towards the end, of course, the evil wins for a while and everything went dark. And then this one little spark lit up, of course, because it's a children's movie, but lit up. And I said, oh, and I said, let's replay that. I said, that just reminds me of resurrection. Those are not words she's ever heard. I mean, they don't talk baptism in her house. They don't talk resurrection in her house, you know, regularly. Mm-hmm. But I'm not afraid to embrace the culture and go, okay, if God is truth, and he is, I will find him here. He will be here. And so that's what I have found, you know, I mean, over and over, you know. Yeah. So what if they were Chinese dragons? There was still baptism and there was still resurrection. I mean, so I don't know. There've got to be ways to embrace the culture,
yeah,
and share the gospel.
Yeah.
But isn't that why people like me love J.R.R. Tolkien or C.S. Lewis or
yes,
fantasy, or, you know, all those things, because all of that has this kernel of truth about who God is and how he works in the world.
And yep, most hero stories do.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's why this cosmic vision of Paul, you know, is an encouragement, because he didn't think he was necessary. He was taking the revelation of the mystery to the Gentiles, but he wasn't speaking of a mystery that wasn't already thoroughly embedded in their lives. You're not bringing Jesus to the masses. You are saying, here are broken signposts. Let me show you that to which they've been pointing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, and my son-in-law, his father was, when he was little, during those really impressionable years, was a chef at an ashram, a Buddha ashram. Mm-hmm. And he really doesn't want his children going to church with me. I mean, unless they want to go. And so that could be a struggle, or that I can embrace that too and figure out, okay, if God is true, where do we work here? It's the arms wide open thing, you guys. That's where, yeah, I'm at right now. Yeah. So not sure how to pull it off, but God knows.
No, it is. That's right. We need a break. Next week, unless baby comes early, I'll be here next week. But I think what we need to do is, we're almost to the end of chapter 3. I thought we'd get there today, but that's okay. But basically what I'm going to do is we'll spend time in Paul's prayer at the end of chapter 3. And then I'm going to kind of give us a flyover of the rest of the letter. and just be done with it. Okay. So we'll call that good. I think you want that for me too, but and really Ephesians 1-3 gives us really the preaching, and 4-6 have a lot of consequence mm-hmm. in light of that, but I think we can do that another time, another way. So that's the idea. We'll see Paul's prayer to the Father, and then we'll go on from there to fly through the rest.
We're all going to get to see a baby soon.
Yeah, I might have to do my first social media post in months. I've gone radio silent.
Yeah, that's all right.
All right. Well, take care, everybody. Enjoy the beautiful day.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye, Sandy.